Cool, that's it.
Alright, so next up we have
Tiff, who's going to
tell us about
pulse. Yes, indeed, thanks to Viagra Rock in the 90s. Stands for the Polarized GLEAM survey. Many of you have heard me give these talks before a lot over the last couple of years with an ever increasing number of sources and prettier and prettier pictures. There's a whole bunch of people who've contributed to this in various different ways, providing scripts, developing a lot of the techniques that I've used, and I've drawn together all these people and downloaded the parts of their brain, and this has allowed me to do this. This project has kind of been the last 2 years of my life. Great because I'm finally getting somewhere with this. Well, I say finally getting somewhere. So I'm not going to go through sort of the scientific motivation because essentially it's about magnetic fields, it's about probing the large scale magnetized universe, and doing a whole bunch of prep work for magnetism with SKALO. Which is something that I think people are starting to talk about more and more, but isn't really totally appreciated outside of sort of the pop art community. The Cliff Notes version of what I've been doing, I've re-reduced GLEAM, so covering the entire sky south of depth plus 30. I used the top two GLEAM bands, so we cover the frequency range 170 to 230 MHz. We use the native channel resolution, and we get a typical best sensitivity of about 2 milligaskies per beam. But like that gets worse the further away from the density goes. We run a cataloging, we do a priorized source finding using GLEAM because 3D source finders don't really exist, and in polarization you don't have Gaussian noise, so we only have finders that account for that either. So we essentially have to go through and identify sources and look for peaks in the priority spectrum of the line of sight. You can read more about like the methods and stuff in paper 1. Effectively this is the first low-frequency all-sky RF synthesis survey. It's a huge data challenge, which is something that Shinoa is also familiar with. As Ruby said yesterday, polarization is hard. This is something that I know deep in my bones. Aside from all the intermediate products and everything, each RM cube that I have to do my source finding on is more than a terabyte on disk, which is scary, particularly when you think of moving forward to... Well, it's scary because you can't just open this up in cavers. Most clusters don't have a casual terabyte or more of RAM that you can spend an hour with a KVIS window slowly loading up. So we've had to develop a whole bunch of new and innovative adaptations of existing techniques to actually be able to run the source finding. It's very scary when you look forward to phase 2 polarimetry because with a factor 3 resolution you're all of a sudden staring at 10 terabyte RMC, let alone any additional let alone the increases in your frequency resolution. But the fun bit is that the cataloging is finally complete after the best part of 2 years of my life. I have over 520 sources, including 35 known pulsars, which is great because that's more than double the number that the phase 1 MWA was predicted to find, so that's a nice sort of my cap. Gives us a source density of about 1 source per 50 square degrees, which we can't make an RM grid from that, but it bodes well for future polarization with phase 2 MWA and eventually SKA low, and some of the stuff that the LOFAR community has been, some of the early results from the LOFAR polarization side of things, where they have much deeper, higher resolution data, bodes pretty nice as well. Here's sort of the final version of the pretty plot that I've been showing at a number of meetings over the last couple of years. This is the all-sky distribution of RMs from POGS overlaying on the Offerman 2014 galactic RM map. Circles are extragalactic sources, squares are known pulsars. Note that the lack of RMs on the galactic plane is a selection effect, because at the time of processing, the GLEAM galactic plane catalogue wasn't available. So things get messy in the galactic plane anyway. The size of the symbols is related to the magnitude of the RM, as seen near the top, and red are positive RMs denoting the magnetic field along the line of sight pointing towards you, and blue are RMs, negative RMs pointing away from you. The distribution is highly related to foregrounds. You can see it's also very much non-uniform. These are highly clustered, which perhaps tells you something about the foreground physics. As you get closer to this black curve up here, which is the depth plus 30, the lack of sources So the closer to that region is, it's just simply sensitivity, but most of the region where we have this sort of varied sensitivity, varied cluster distribution, is actually reasonably uniform sensitivity. You take your pick of 4 grams and compare the distribution and you'll learn something. As I said, yeah, it's highly non-uniform, partially related to sensitivity, but quite a lot related to 4 grams. We don't detect any sources along the North Polar Spur, for example. And broadly speaking, where the foreground, where there's less stuff going on in the foreground, that's where we tend to have a higher density of source. Some of the larger absolute RMs, such as over here, are linked to H2 regions. You've got Sharpe 27 there, which has some pretty large RMs. You've got the H-alpha arc of the Gamma Nebula there, which again, we have quite a large, quite a number of large absolute RMs. And then you have a number of regions which are where you've got clusters, you've got sources clustered in regions of low foreground. Although you will note there's this nice, there's this region here where we have a massive overdensity, and then this region here where the foreground is quite low, that we have a massive underdensity, which I'll come on to and spend a few minutes talking about that. This is a pretty boring region of the galaxy that no matter what wavelength you look at, there's not a lot going on here in the foreground. Pick H alpha or the looking at dust, and we have this nice cluster of sources here where there's pretty low foreground. But then you have this region here, where there again the foreground is quite low, but we don't see any sources. Is that a selection effect, is that sensitivity, or is that telling us something about the foreground? Well, if you go to catalogues at similar sensitivity but different frequencies, where you are sensitive to different different properties in different where you have different Faraday space sensitivity, then compare them and then you can learn something. So here I take the SPARS ACTU catalogue from Dominic Schnitzler and collaborators. It's not the most fun catalogue to work with. I will be political and say that. If you break out the sort of where the galactic plane cutoff is, where I don't look for sources, then you get a massive look like this. So we have a pretty comparable resolution and reasonably comparable sensitivity because SPARS is pretty shallow survey, but because we're at low frequencies, we have absolutely, we have heaps better RM resolution, about 3 radians per square meter as opposed to about 90 radians per square meter, but with a max scale of only about 2 radians per square meter, we're essentially only sensitive to structures that are thin in Faraday space, whereas at higher frequencies, you're sensitive to much more extended, more complex structures in Faraday space. And you can see we're mostly clustered here, we have no sources there, whereas the distribution in the Schnitzler et al. Catalogue is broadly uniform. So perhaps this is telling us something about foreground physics. Do you have questions? Do you want to jump in or something?
Are the circles on the same scale?
Yes, the circles are on the same scale. Well, as broadly, as much as I could do on the same scale, yes. So this perhaps tells us we're probing the galactic foreground. 5 minutes? Cool. I don't think I've got too much more. So we can try and quantify this using pulses of probes for galactic foregrounds. If you compare our pulse RM, which is shown on the y-axis of both of these plots, versus the galactic foreground, again, you've got a pretty good correspondence. Likewise, if you take the Taylor RMs from MVSS, you have a very good correspondence, which is slightly surprising considering they only have 2 frequencies and they suffer the whole entire ambiguity problem. We have these regions where you've got sort of these magnetized foreground structures along the one side, or these H2 regions where you have these larger RMs and they really stick out like sore thumbs. And so some of this, effectively, what this is telling us, we have good correspondence with higher frequency surveys, but with these differences that we see between the RMs we measure with POGS and the galactic foreground RM, galactic RM can't explain the whole picture. So perhaps we're getting more we're sensitive to more of an extragalactic RM component than I was initially expecting. I follow up with these kind of with further higher frequency broadband surveys, and POSM are really critical to filling out this whole picture of the magnetized structure. Particularly in the southern sky, where we have a lower, we have much fewer surveys that have actually covered the southern sky. So my conclusion after 18 months, 2 years of my life, Polarized is finally complete. We're dominated by AGN, although we've detected 35 known pulsars. One thing that I didn't really mention, typically we have way more than order of magnitude improvement in the precision of these RMC measure. For a lot of these sources, it's more like 2 orders of magnitude improvement. Distribution tells us about foreground physics. Low-frequency RM surveys, it seems, are quite highly sensitive to foreground physics. We have a lot of large RM, well, we have quite a few large RMs that are linked to structures in the foreground. Something I didn't really touch on, but I can always talk more about either in questions or later. We have some sources that exhibit evidence of complex physics, and we're following up those with higher frequency data. Paper 1 you can read, paper 2, which is your sky sample, is in prep. And if you have any interesting ideas for things we can do with this and collaborate, then just ask. And I'll stop there and say thanks for listening to your questions.
More than a question, probably a comment. And indeed, it was pleasing to see that you have probably detected more pulsars than you have done in the time domain. But my question is that have you checked what sort of CM range that sample cover?
The pulsars? No, I haven't.
Yeah, because obviously you know that you probably won't be constrained because of temporal flaring that you will have in the time series analysis. So I was just curious if I know that that probably includes like a bright, very high CM object in this case. You know that this is you know, the useful way of detecting those pulsars.
Yeah, no, I would agree entirely, and that's something that I want to look at, and I want to talk to many hours and sort of cross-match the catalogs, and partly as a verification, so any you detected in polarization with the VCS observations, just check that we agree, it'd be a great sanity check, and also see if we can do some vision science with these interplane detections. I didn't really cover that. So the solid black lines are effectively the horizon limit of the GLEAM catalog. So it's about deck minus 85 or so, and then deck plus 30. You've got the large and small Magellanic clouds there in those two dashed regions. That's 10A. That's the side lobe reflection of 10A. And that's this particular region of GLEAM that was hugely ionospherically distorted. So most of those regions I left out because there are no GLEAM sources in there. This particular region here, I actually took a crack at because it was a large enough region of sky that I cared more deeply than parts up here where it's not that a huge region of sky. I used the CGSS as a prior there. Interestingly enough, I've seen Natasha's SOSI images of that region from GLEAM year one. They're horrible, but we detect polarized sources in there really slightly. Like, there's nothing that seems particularly wrong in the polarization data, which is slightly confusing. You'd think if they were horribly ionospherically distorted, we wouldn't find them. But the noise properties look pretty alright, and we detect some sources. I know Kat Ross and Ben Tichy are working on processing, on filling in that region of GLEAM using GLEAM year 2 data, so I'm eagerly awaiting the results of their work. This is something that actually that Zhang has been, Zhang, myself and Natasha have been looking at, particularly with a view to phase 2 and the slightly more competition we have for Magnus resources. It seems there's not actually too much of an additional overhead in terms of calibration. Most of the calibration steps are actually, we need to do the same thing for continuum processing and polarization. The larger overhead is that we have to image every channel. when you're at these long wavelengths, the second you start to do too much channel averaging, you start to lose sources through depolarization. With 40 kilohertz channels, you can still get really good, like, with 40 kilohertz channels, we're sensitive to RMs up to about 1100 radians per square meter. There's nothing in the Taylor catalog that's beyond about 600 or 700 radians per square meter. So you're large, unless you're looking in the galaxy, you're largely safe doing a fair amount of channel averaging. Disk space overheads are a different matter because we've got to store all the products, we've got to do leakage, instrumental leakage correction, ionospheric correction, so we need all of those products along the way. For phase one MWA on disk, for each epoch, before getting to RM cubes, you're looking at about 50 terabytes of disk space.
Yes,
that would be important. I'm not sure.